Hello and welcome to another edition of Payday TV. I'm Dominic Piper. Today we're joined by Western Areas Managing Director, Dan Locker. Dan, thanks for joining us.
It's a pleasure always.
Dan, I want to start by asking you about your Odysseus nickel project here in Western Australia. You purchased it 5 years ago now nearly from Glencore. And at the time, I think a lot of people thought it was just a bolt-on to your Forrestania operations. But if we look at it now, the size of the reserve there, the size of the project you've got there, it's something much more, isn't it? It's a real long-life asset.
Yes, look, I mean, you know, we've already released to the market sort of several years ago that this is a 10-year mine life minimum on based on current reserves. We will be adding to that reserve with an EM6 reserve due out shortly, which will push probably the mine life, you know, to more closer to 15 years.
You've guided first ore in financial year 2022. Are you still on target to hit that? And how are things progressing at Odysseus?
Well, no, things are progressing really well. We've had a couple of hiccups on the way. I mean, the winder and the headframe repairs was delayed slightly. But I must make a point here that that will not prevent us from mining ore and trucking ore to surface. It's not the preferred way, because obviously we want to use the shaft hoisting system. But we did have the COVID-19 affecting some of that work over in South Africa. But that's back on track now, and we're expecting that equipment to come through in sort of the October month. And we're looking forward now to firing the twin, which I'm going to rename the Odysseus decline. So this is the first time I've actually in the market with that, and those twin declines going down now, fresh rock mining will occur hopefully within the next couple of weeks.
You mentioned the headframe and the shaft hoist system. It's not something we see a lot of here in Australian underground mining. Can you explain the rationale behind Western Areas putting in the shaft hoist?
Yeah, look, it's pretty basic. I mean, if you come from the era where I come from, I mean, you know, working in South Africa and back in Wales, I mean, hoisting shafts were the norm, right? And even in Australia, back in the, you know, the 60s, 50s, 60s, 70s, even up to the 80s, they were mining with shafts as well. Now, we went through an era of open pit mining, so it made more sense, you know, put declines down from the open pit. That was the logic, and only, you know, open up resources below your, basically below your feet or the pit floor. So it was done incrementally. And when you've got a mine life of 10-year minimum, the hoisting capacity and the cost of that capacity versus trucking, not to mention, you know, diesel particulates and the environmental requirements. It's a no-brainer, really, when you look at the operating cost structure for a long-life mine. It also allows you to lower the cut-off grades a little bit, which we did, to make it a bigger deposit for a bigger reserve, basically, to be mined.
It's an exciting project for a company of Western Areas, long-standing as a nickel producer, to have a second project coming
20 on. Years.
20 years of nickel production out of Forrestania. Is that 20 years enabling you now to fund this project?
Well, look, you know, we've been very fortunate, you know, to have those deposits producing cash. And, of course, you know, we've got cash at bank. So combined with both of those, look, we're pretty comfortable at the moment. Nickel is looking reasonably good, you know, around about the $650 a pound. So, look, if we continue to generate good cash, we will be able to do that out of cash. But, look, we've been offered a lot of various, you know, banking facilities, convertible bonds. And, look, you know, we're not running out to any bank at the moment. So we're quite comfortable.
You mentioned earlier the AM6 reserve will come into the mine life shortly. Is there further exploration potential to expand that mine life at Odysseus?
Yes, look, I mean, we've got an exploration team up there right now at the moment. That belt running was very underexplored back in both in Jubilee and Xstrata. Glencore really didn't do much. And then, of course, you've got the Mount Goode deposit, which is, you know, huge. And that's literally above the M5, M6. So that we haven't touched since the Jubilee days.
I'm sure there's a lot of people in the WA nickel scene excited to hear that those old Cosmos, those old Jubilee assets are going to be tested once again. Just turning to Forrestania now, your innovations there and your mine extensions there are based less on exploration and engineering, but more on metallurgy, really. You've introduced a new flow sheet there, the MREP flow sheet. Can you explain a little bit about that project and what it's delivering for Forrestania?
So we have to start thinking about innovation. And about 10 years ago, we actually bought a company called BioHeap, which is bacterial leaching, leaching of sulfides. And it can do pretty much any sulfide. We built a plant, we call it the Mill Recovery Enhancement Project. We take some tailings, which has got arsenic, so it's really good for removing arsenic, which obviously is not a good element to go into the concentrate. But the back end of that plant is the precipitation area where we produce a very high grade 45% sulfide concentrate, which we sell into refineries right now. That can do 4,000 nickel tons. The leaching tanks, which we use for the sort of nickel arsenic part of the sequence coming from the mill, we actually have about 1,000 ton, 1,400 ton capacity. So the MRE plant can actually do a lot more. So our job is to find a stream of nickel sulfate solution to feed the precipitation plant at the back end. But we do have SCATS projects, which is currently being commissioned, fully permitted. There's 285,000, we'll do a heap leach, and that will be our first practical demonstration of actually leaching through heap leaching, not through tank leaching, and feeding that nickel sulfate solution into the precipitation area of the MREP. If it works, it'll be a big, big step, because then we can start looking at other feedstocks.
Outside of the established operations at Forrestania and also Odysseus, you've returned to the drill bit in the greenfield space. You're drilling at the Western Gawler project in South Australia. Western Gawler looks like it's got similarities to the Nebo Babel deposit that OZ Minerals are currently developing. You've had some early success in the drilling there. What's the next step?
Well, look, you know, now, as with all exploration, you know, the first hole, you hit the mineralization, not the deposit, and we get asked, you know, how big is it? How many tons has it got? We now have to go back to fundamental drilling and geophysical moving loop. The Western Gawler is like 10,000 square kilometers, and we've just hit sulfide mineralization in one area. So you can imagine there's a lot of other areas we want to explore, but we do have to develop it, and that's the plan right now.
With Odysseus, Western Gawler, and your investment in Panoramic Resources as well, suggests to me that you're fully committed to the nickel sector. What's driving that commitment to nickel?
The electrification of vehicles is actually going to, I think, take quite a big leap post the virus, when you know, the world goes back to normality. EV sales in Europe up until now is actually outstripping your combustion engines.
I can see why you're excited. The EV market is quite tense at the moment as a lot of the manufacturers try and work out their supply chains, particularly around lithium and cobalt. And we're seeing some of those can manufacturers actually head upstream to try and secure supply. Is the same happening in nickel? Have you been approached by any car manufacturers?
You know, when Elon Musk back in the day talked about, lithium is just the salt on the salad and nickel is the main game. And of course, he came out recently with, we'd love to, meet people that have got sustainable, nickel production. Well, I reckon that one tweet probably got him a lot of phone calls from pretty much everybody in Australia, from junior explorers up to the majors. So I think it's coming. The volumes that you need to maintain an 811 battery, which is currently the spec that people are trying to get into their cars, is actually quite significant. And the change in volumes out of the more stainless steel market is going to actually create quite a buzz.
Dan, thanks for your time today. Good luck with Odysseus and the development there, also at Forrestania, and of course exploration in the Western Gawler. And we'll all keep an eye out for Elon Musk's next nickel-related tweet. Thank you.
Thank you.